Welcome, friends. Welcome back to the kitchen. Welcome back to Sunday Morning in the Old Cookbook Show. Today, we're going to do a recipe out of this cookbook. This is called Duncan Hines, Adventures in Good Cooking and the Art of Carving in the Home. This particular copy was printed in 1953. Duncan Hines is a real guy. In the group of fictitious names that you find in your supermarket, when you walk through the baking aisle or any of the aisles, there's all kinds of fictitious characters whose names and faces are on cans and boxes and everything else. Duncan Hines is a real guy. Duncan Hines is a real guy. So all of those boxed cake mixes, there is an actual person behind them. So Duncan Hines starts out in the 1930s, and this book is probably his first foray. It's called Adventures in Good Eating. It's a travelogue. It's a travel guide to the highways and byways of the United States. At a time before the U.S. interstate system starts, the first one was published in 1936. So Duncan and his wife are out there traveling really horrible roads across the United States, pulling into towns, eating at restaurants and staying at hotels, and often the restaurants are in the hotels. This is a time before the homogenization of the United States. This is a time before practically every highway stop in the United States started to look the same, with the same dozen brands of hotels and chain restaurants at every stop. They would go in and they would eat and stay and then write it up in this book. And it is incredibly dull. Incredibly dull. A man of very few words was Duncan Hines. So we're going to make a cake today, and we'll get to that in a little bit. But we're going to start out, we're going to put some butter in here and some sugar into the stand mixer, and we're going to get that creaming together. So he didn't rate any of the restaurants or the hotels. He wasn't like the Michelin guide. He didn't give stars. He didn't really say whether they were great or not. His information was really just much more functional. At random, in Orange, Massachusetts, the White Drum gives the address, when they're open from May 15th to November 1st. It's very attractive, very modern. You'll find a pleasing contrast to the 1775 atmosphere of many of the eating places I've mentioned hereabouts. Duck and steak dinners are especially popular at the White Drum. If you're planning to stop on Sunday or a holiday, you'd better make reservations. Here's the telephone number, and it's going to cost you between 85 cents and $2 to eat there. Basic information. Book packed with basic information. And every year it changed. And a companion to the guidebook are his cooking books, his recipe books. And these are recipes. Generally, these books sort of overlap. The travel books start in 1936. The cookbooks start in 1939. And the one that I'm holding in my hand is from 1953. And they're mostly recipes from places that he stopped, speaks to the owners. If he ate something that he really liked, he got the recipe, put it in his recipe books. And some of the recipes in here are from him. They're his personal recipes, or recipes from his wife. And the cake that we're doing today is from his wife, the chocolate cake supreme. 1953 is also at about the same time that the first Duncan Hines boxed cake mixes are coming to market. Now, I'm not saying that, you know, a cake recipe from the Hines household is one of the first ones, but you know, you'd like to dream it was. Now, the recipe calls for 2 squares of melted chocolate. He says to do it in a double boiler. I'm going to do it in the microwave. Now, the next thing is to take this melted chocolate and put it in with our butter and sugar mixture. I find these recipes laid out in a very interesting way, and it's a way that was popular for a very small amount of time and then kind of went away again. One where each ingredient is listed on one side, and then what you're going to do with that ingredient is listed on the other side. Kind of a call and response type recipe. I don't really know how I feel about this layout. I can see how it would be more intuitive for some people, and more confusing for some people. I don't know the reason why this style went away for cookbooks. Now, we have to separate our eggs. The yolks go into this mixture and the whites get beaten separately. So, whites into the copper bowl for whipping. Yolks into the mixing cup for mixing. This is where I mix in the vanilla. Egg yolks and vanilla into the chocolate butter sugar mixture. Next up, we need to deal with our dry and wet ingredients. So here I have cake flour, specifically calls for cake flour, salt, and baking powder. Tells me to sift it together 3 times. There we go. And I need 1.5 cups of sweet milk. Oh, bag's empty. There we go. And sweet milk is just milk, probably whole milk. I'm using 3.25% because that's what our whole milk is here in Canada, or where I live in Canada. It's just sweet milk, regular milk. Doesn't mean sweetened milk. That would be something completely different. It's just regular milk. It's to differentiate between sweet milk and sour milk, or what we today would call buttermilk if you're buying it at the grocery store. So I'm supposed to alternate between flour and milk into the stand mixer. And then I need to fold in the egg whites. I'm going to get the egg whites ready so that I don't end up over mixing this batter. There we go. That's good. Okay. Alternate dry and wet. So a few spoonfuls of the flour mixture. And then a little drizzle of the milk. And we just go back and forth until it's all mixed in. Now we fold the egg whites into the batter, about 1/3 at a time. First third, you don't have to be too precious with. Get it in there. This is a very loose batter to begin with. And if you've whipped your egg whites to the right point, folding becomes pretty easy. If you've got your egg whites to the point where they look really dry and there's liquid coming out the bottom, you've whipped them too far and folding them in just isn't going to happen. I would always go for under whipping than over whipping. So, next set goes in. Do your best with the folding. It's really not that big of a deal. And the last bit of egg whites. There we go, that's it. Now, I've got 2 9-inch cake pans that I've greased and put a parchment paper in the bottom. And we need to divide this between the 2 cake pans as best you can, as evenly as you can. I don't ever go to the point where I'm, you know, weighing it on a scale, but I know for some people, that's the way they do it, and it works out perfectly every time. I am much more of an eyeball it person. Precision is overrated. Okay, couple of taps. I think I'm gonna put these on a baking tray. The oven is preheated to 350 degrees Fahrenheit, and these go in for about a half hour. Okay, cakes are out of the oven, they're cooling down. We're gonna make the frosting. Kind of an interesting frosting. So, supposed to take an egg, and we're gonna mix this up in the stand mixer. Next in is some powdered sugar. I'm only making half of the frosting recipe because I'm not a huge fan of lots of frosting. Next step is to work the sugar into the egg. There's not a lot of egg to moisten this much sugar, so it might take a while. After that, I'm supposed to mix in chocolate and butter melted together. So I've melted the two together, mixed them up, did it in the microwave like I always do. I think that's about as mixed together as I'm gonna get with the sugar and egg. So in goes the butter and chocolate. That'll loosen it up quite a bit. It's starting to come together. So I'm supposed to put in some vanilla, which is, you know, measured carefully. Then some lemon juice. I've never put lemon juice in a chocolate frosting before, so we'll see how this goes. Not a whole lot, 2 teaspoons. So, look at that. There doesn't seem to be any seeds in this one. I'm gonna call that two teaspoons. I should scrape off the bottom too. Even though this beater bar has a rubber scraper attached to it, doesn't work all that well at all. Okay, put that in. I'm also supposed to put in some whipping cream. Let's mix this together first. Okay, whipping cream. And chopped nuts. And so, welcome to the part of every cake recipe ever done on this channel that I absolutely despise, and that's the part where you frost the cake. So, frost the cake however you at home would like to frost the cake. I haven't decided yet if I'm going to frost the whole thing or if I'm just going to put frosting in between and on top. I guess you'll find out in a moment when Julie gets here for the taste test. So I did decide to put icing all the way down the sides. If I had to do it over, I would not put the crushed nuts in the frosting because it made it very hard to spread. That's a pretty good looking cake.
Woohoo! Cake! Hey friends! Hey Glenn! And it's iced! It's super special!
It is super special. It is so super special, Julie. It is. It is a Duncan Hines chocolate cake from scratch. I love that I can say that.
Okay.
It's not a Duncan Hines box cake.
It's a chocolate cake.
It is the chocolate cake supreme.
It's a very light colored chocolate cake.
It is a very light
color. What makes it such a light color? Can I dig in?
Go right ahead.
All right.
It's from Mrs. Duncan Hines, Bowling Green, Kentucky.
Mrs. Duncan Hines, that's funny.
So maybe she did the baking. Maybe she invented the box cake that bears Duncan Hines' name.
Mm-hmm.
There's whipped eggs whites in this too.
So it's a pretty moist cake.
Mm. Light and airy.
Mm-hmm. It's very light. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it is surprisingly light. That's mm-hmm. gotta be all those egg whites.
Mm-hmm. Mm, that's wonderful. So I did cut down, only made half of the frosting, which I think provided
an adequate amount of frosting. Oh my.
And even though I only made half, I still didn't end up using it all.
That's a pretty good cake. I could definitely
throw
down some tea and I could finish that off. Yeah. The frosting's quite nice too.
It is. And so I wondered about the lemon juice. So there was lemon juice in it.
Mm-hmm.
I think there's the lemon juice apparently sort of cuts.
Is there nuts in the cake too, or just in the icing?
Just in the icing. And I would not do that again. Anyway, the lemon juice, I think, just cuts some of the sweetness. Well, I already have a hard enough time frosting a cake.
Okay. So what about your technique of icing? Okay.
You put chopped nuts in there and it just became a mess. Look at that.
It's a nice little surprise, the chewy bits. But you were saying about the lemon. Sorry about that.
The lemon cuts some of the sweetness or provides a foil. It's still very sweet, but it provides a foil. That acidity provides a foil to the icing sugar.
So there you
go.
That
is a great cake.
If you ever wanted to make a Duncan Hines from scratch, apparently this is it.
This is the one. Thanks for stopping by. See you again soon.